In today's video, I will analyze and geolocate video footage filmed of the highly destructive 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens. While the destructive eruption began at 8:32 a.m. on May 18, 1980, all of the footage shown in this video was recorded between 9:30 a.m. and 12:30 p.m. on the same day. Let's get started. What you are looking at is a superheated pyroclastic fluid racing down the western slopes of Mount St. Helens during its catastrophic 1980 eruption. It can be difficult to get a sense of scale to determine the speed or size of the 800 degrees Fahrenheit or 427 degrees Celsius superheated gas current we are looking at, so I have geolocated this footage to determine its speed. Starting at around 1,200 feet or 366 meters west of what was at the time its newly formed collapsed scar rim, in only a time span of 3.34 seconds, this pyroclastic flow advanced 105.54 meters or 346.26 feet. This translates to a speed of 70.7 miles per hour or 113.8 kilometers per hour. While still a high speed, this velocity is only in the lower to mid-range of typical pyroclastic flow speeds, which can range anywhere from 10 to 450 miles per hour. As it advanced across the landscape, everything organic was scorched in its path, and even if you were to have hypothetically been on a tall ridge, you wouldn't have been safe, due in part to its height of 93.7 meters or 307.4 feet. However, even above this height wouldn't have been safe due in part to the rising plume of material behind the front of the pyroclastic flow in what is referred to as a Coignimbrite plume. Pyroclastic flows are not simply superheated gas currents, as they also contain dust to house sized blocks of lava, pumice, and ash moving at incredibly high speeds. If you are looking for a specific figure, pyroclastic flows by volume can be anywhere from 0.07% to 20% composed of rock, hence why they often leave behind a thick pile of material where they travel. A Coignimbrite plume simply involves slightly less dense and smaller sorted particles of pyroclastic flow material which are propelled upwards by a buoyant column of air. These Coignimbrite plumes can be equally as destructive as the pyroclastic flow which created it, sometimes reaching several kilometers in height. In many images and videos of this Mount St. Helens eruption, you will note a distinctive mushroom cloud. These mushroom clouds, if they are sustained, specifically if they reach above 20 kilometers or 65,600 feet in height, are a distinguishing feature of what are called Plinian eruptions. Plinian and ultra-Plinian eruptions represent the most energetic and powerful types of volcanic eruptions, with the name originating from a description Pliny the Elder made of Vesuvius's 79 CE eruption which destroyed Pompeii. He likened the shape of the eruption plume to that of a stone pine tree, and you can definitely see the resemblance between the two. So, how did a mushroom cloud form? Whenever an unusually energy-dense and hot plume is suddenly created from a point source, whether this be a powerful explosion or a large volcanic eruption, a hot and central plume will shoot upwards. However, since the warm air is unstable and cold air is forced upwards, it creates a cycling motion at the edges of the plume, causing its edge to become wider and wider. The upward motion of the plume then continues until the gas reaches equilibrium and the air above it becomes stable. At this point, the convection continues but causes the plume to spread out even further, forming the flat top of the mushroom cloud. You might be wondering exactly how fast the eruption plume from Mount St. Helens rose. And, while it varies, in this video clip, a buoyant ash column which has a density of around 1.5 kilograms per cubic meter is rising at a rate of 68 miles per hour. This translates to an upward motion of 6,000 feet per minute. If you want to see more analysis of additional Mount St. Helens eruption footage, be sure to comment down below and let me know. As a final note, I would like to thank my new patron, Larry Gilman, for supporting this channel.